गरम चाहिए था, नरमा मिर्ची में।
Good evening, everyone. My name is Rohini, Rohini Manchanda. I'm a public speaker and associated with SeekMed. SeekMed is the global telemedicine platform which connects the patients from around the globe to India's award-winning doctors through a video consultation. As you all know that we keep bringing our very senior experts and specialists to talk about all the health problems and care so that our viewers and users are very well informed about everything related to healthcare. Today, we're going to talk about a very important aspect of our life, sleep. We often talk to each other telling that I'm sleep deprived or, you know, I always oversleep because we're never sure that are we getting enough sleep or not. Is it too much or is it too less? Because according to us, we never get enough sleep, isn't it? So our topic today is led by a sleep specialist to tell us, are we sleeping enough to keep ourselves healthy? So let me welcome a highly renowned doctor, Dr. Manvi Bhatia, senior neurologist and sleep specialist, director of Neurology and Sleep Center, New Delhi, Vice President of Indian Society for Sleep Research, ISSR, author of the first non-fiction book on sleep, The Sleep Solution. So very warm welcome to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Roshni. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, I request you to please give a brief introduction about your specialty and expertise, please.
So I'm a neurologist with a special interest in this entity, which is recent in the medicine field. It's called as sleep medicine. People sometimes ask and wonder, what is this specialty? So we deal with any and every complaint related to sleep, whether it is difficulty in falling asleep, staying asleep, feeling very sleepy, tired during the day, sleep walking, talking, any abnormal behavior in sleep. So anything which is related to sleep is what we address. And so I do this by consultation. We do it by evaluation of sleep. And that's how we move forward. And I've been in this field now for almost more than 25, 28 years, and it's been a fascinating journey.
That's great, ma'am. Thank you so much. So before starting our questions, I would like to inform all our viewers that this is a live webinar. And if there's anything that you want to ask the doctor or have any related query, please write to us on comments and we will try to take up all the questions right away. So let's begin. Ma'am, the first and foremost question would be, you know, how many hours of sleep is needed by a person, and you know, how does one know that I've got enough sleep? So how does it work out?
Yeah, so sleep is a very, very fascinating subject, and the first question, rightly so, is how many hours does anybody even understand that how many hours of sleep is needed? So for that, I would ask everybody to think for a few seconds, 5 or 10 seconds. How many hours of sleep do you get at night? So how do you calculate that? You calculate the time that you went to bed or fell asleep and the time that you woke up. And yes, if we were to do a open kind of a session, you would get all kinds of answers. Somebody will say 4 hours, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Today I've seen a person who's sleeping 12 hours. So there is a range, but let's say by and large, the subjects or people would fall somewhere between 7 and 8. And on the two extremes, we will have people who have less than 6 hours and people who are sleeping more than 9 hours. So amongst your friends, amongst each other, you can do this exercise and see this variable pattern. But the next question, which is really the pertinent question, is that, and people don't realize this often, how many hours of sleep do you need? So whenever I ask this, people are not really confident. What does this mean? See, we all know how much food that we need to eat, what quantity of rice or what quantity of rotis or whatever. So that's the food or the appetite or that satiety hormone which comes in and says, okay, enough. So similar thing is for the sleep. Each of us has a separate need. We are not all same. Each one is a unique individual. So somebody who needs 7 hours should get 7 hours. Somebody who needs 8 hours should get 8 hours. And that's what is called as a sleep need. And if you get less sleep than what you need, that is called something called as a sleep debt. Meaning that you owe your body that many hours. And in the times, especially the current scenario, we've seen that people are accumulating the sleep debt, meaning that if you have less sleep, every night 1 or 2 hours. By the end of the week, you have a debt of about 8 or 10 hours. So that's, you need to understand your own sleep need.
Great, ma'am. Thank you so much. And what happens to the body at night when we say that, you know, that this is, as you say, that the body, you know, it's about, depends on the need of the person, how is the appetite is about, on, it depends on, you know, person to person, it varies from person to person. But what exactly happens to the body at night, and how does the results of poor sleep impact us?
So, first of all, there are some habits, you know, we have, we consider these habits bad. You know, if it's somebody is eating a lot of junk food, we always say, oh, you know, this is not a good idea. If somebody is smoking or taking excessive alcohol, it's not a bad idea. But somehow, when people are not sleeping adequate number of hours, it's still considered a badge of honor. So, and our repeated efforts are that please do not consider this a very big thing that you are having less sleep. So how do I know that I have got enough sleep? First and foremost is, do you need an alarm clock to wake you up? So people will be surprised, but yes, ideally you're supposed to wake up without an alarm clock. Second, how do you feel on when you wake up? Are you refreshed, energetic, and ready to go? Or are you tired? So these few things will tell you that are you getting adequate sleep or not? And also, how do you feel during the day? So as the day goes on, your productivity, your creativity, you're feeling happy, or you are just sad and tired. So think about these few things and you will get to know that, have I got adequate sleep or not? And of course, this brain fog, that means there's just constant clouding and you can't focus and concentrate. So just wanted to share with you that there's enough research which says that less than 6 hours of sleep is equal to the legal limits or the permissible limits of alcohol. So people say that you would not be driving, you would not be trying to concentrate and work if you had the alcohol levels higher than permissible. So similarly, less than 6 hours of sleep, you should not do all those things. What really happens in the body? Why is this sleep so important? I'm going to just give you a snapshot of just a few things. We can't cover the whole thing in this webinar or this live session. So first and foremost, there are numerous hormones which peak at night. And there is this growth hormone, which is important, of course, for children, that it gives them the height and makes them grow. But it's important for all ages. It's what's responsible for your muscle repair and growth, your bone repair and growth, and overall makes you stronger. So thus, if you do not get this or get adequate sleep, your growth hormone is not going to peak and your body will not become strong. This is what the growth hormone really does. Second is that the less sleep makes you obese. So this is, enough studies and research has proven this. Why it does it? It's because it messes up with the hormones, which tell you not only what to eat, but how much to eat. So both go haywire. So there's a craving for carbohydrate rich, sweet, sugary things at night. So the later you stay awake at night, the tendency to snack on these things becomes much higher. And this is what happens if you don't get adequate sleep at night. Coming to the current scenario, during sleep at night, the body is kind of getting ready for war, as it were. That means it sends out a lot of these molecules and cells which fight infection. And so in a way, it's the biggest immunity booster. So we can take the vitamins, we can do everything. But if you do not get sleep, your natural body resources, as we call them, to fight the infection are not there. So in the current scenario or in any scenario, you will see that this weakens your immunity system and you can get more frequent colds, coughs. And there's also been research that people who got less sleep, their antibody production to vaccines was much poor. So in fact, they're saying that when the vaccine does come, please ensure that you get good sleep, then get the vaccine, because your antibodies will be boosted in a much better manner. Overall, there is decreased productivity. So you may also take wrong decisions. So these are the kind of things which are very subtle, but which, and of course, accidents, like we already discussed this. So just to summarize and say that lack of sleep in whatever the cause may be, will affect each and every part of your body, starting from the brain, the heart, the muscle, etc. So I hope that we have convinced that not only the night, but the day is also impacted. So this is in nutshell what happens to the brain, or to the body, physically, the whole time that we are asleep, because it makes us just ready for the day and for the future.
That's certainly true. And that's very insightful, ma'am. Thank you so much. And as we talk about it, actually, as you talked about it, so we have one question from our viewers, which, you know, we asked that. So I am on my nighttime duty and I sleep only during the day. So does it impact me? Is it healthy? But I feel fresh because I sleep enough hours during the day.
So this is of course, a common question that these are called shift work. So we are sleeping in the time that we are meant to be awake, and obviously then you sleep and the otherwise, but that's fine. But for shift work, there are certain rules how often one should change the shift. And yes, at all costs, get adequate sleep during the day and make sure you allocate enough time for exercise and stuff. But if shift work starts interfering with your daytime sleep and starts making you feel sick and ill, or your mood changes, then it's time to take a call. But otherwise, it's fine. Nurses, engine drivers, a lot of people, doctors are all doing shift work.
Right, that's a very valid point. But because actually, you know, we've been all hearing since the beginning of everything, you know, that the night sleep is very important. It's not about, you know, if you sleep during the day, that does not complete your sleep. Because I think, you know, they say that 3 to 5 sleep is very much important for a lot of people say a lot of other things. So I think that clears
yeah, but,
a lot of...
So for shift work, it's really good. I mean, it's okay. It's necessary. But for people who just move their cycles, I wouldn't advise them. I've just seen a person today who's sleeping at 5 a.m. I saw a girl the other day who's sleeping at 10 a.m. So I asked them, what do you do? So they are just on Netflix and TV series. And then the sleep, that sleep is just not good quality. So they are very disturbed. So shift work is good. I mean, it's part of our job and our careers, but otherwise, please do not try and switch these cycles around.
I think, ma'am, you kind of touched the soft part of all the generation, of the youth right now, that Netflix, yes, and binging, you know, that web series, everyone's been doing that ever since the lockdown, and everyone's schedule has become really...
We've had a surge of people coming forward and taking help. It's a much more higher number that I have seen in the past few years.
Wow. But I'm glad that you're here to help. And I think, you know, the session as well could help a lot of people understand that what exactly sleep does to our body and how important it is, because we do not really focus on this much a lot. So I'm moving forward. Let's say, what are the common reasons? I mean, apart from binging Netflix and web series, what are the common reasons
for poor sleep
pattern? And, you know, what can be done to improve it?
Yeah. So I'm just going to go a little one step back and say that we talked a lot about what is the impact of poor sleep. So what does the research say that if you get good sleep, what happens? So it was very enlightening and also encouraging that it's been seen that if you sleep well, you are much more happier. So that's one thing. So, and especially in children or also in adults. So it's been seen with their scholastic performance, and similarly in office, people are more productive, they are more social, there's engagement, and they're always happy. So in fact, there's also a kind of a consensus or a myth that are we sleep deprived and are we more angry now? And obesity has a very strong relationship. People also get less heart attacks. They get less angry. They take more healthier decisions, let's say. They take care of their health. Common reasons, actually, besides all that, it's just if you do a wide survey, people just say, oh, you know, I have not been able to finish my work. So I need to extend the day into the night. And in a way, maybe the current scenario, the other day only we were talking to some another journalist and they were asking, and also my patients are saying that initially, or the office hours, they would end when they would come home. Now that those hours have got extended way into the night. So 9 p.m., 10 p.m., you are still available, you're available on emails, on calls, whatever. So this, the work is just not getting over. So the day just enters the night. The second major reason is any kind of anxiety, stress. And that also we see in the current times that we are in, there's a lot of fear. There's fear of your career, there's fear of your health, fear of your loved one's health, fear of your family, fear of this virus. When is it going? When is it coming? Are we in the third peak? People are just constantly watching news and, you know, discussing. So that starts releasing a lot of, let's say, hormones or chemicals in the body, which interfere with sleep. So these people, they're not able to fall asleep. In fact, the other day, another person said, her own words were, it's as if that I have forgotten how to fall asleep. You know, and that is creating a very big worry because it seems I can't sleep. And the whole night and they lie awake. So this is a very, very big factor. Was always there, but it has like touched a big peak. We also have these screens, which we've already discussed. But just to say why, there is this light in the screen, which will suppress the sleep-inducing hormone. There's like definite science behind it. It's not that just people are just saying, okay, please put off the screens, put off the screens. That's one. And second, when you are watching something, you are mentally engaged. If you are engaged, you can't suddenly switch off. So people have a tendency to switch off their screen, switch off the light and think I'll go to bed and sleep will come. But sleep doesn't come. And that starts off another cycle. So the screens create poor sleep, the poor sleep, then they get up and again, people start watching the screen. So that cycle goes on, which is not a good idea. But all kinds of disorders. So these things apart, any disorder could be like, see, a simple fever can produce a poor sleep. You have cough with all, any viruses can produce. Any pains in the body, arthritis, backache, lot of neurological conditions. We have also things like snoring, very loud, persistent snoring, pain in the legs, kicking of the legs at night. So poor sleep is just a symptom. We need to figure out what is the cause and approach in that manner. And when I talk to my patients, they're almost giving me the answers themselves. You know, this is what I was doing and that's what happened. So I think you just need some introspection to think that why is my sleep gone bad? So all this put together, I think we should understand that sleep is a very important thing. It's an essential, it's said to be the third pillar of health, but the sleep specialists say that it is the foundation for health. You have nutrition, you have exercise, and you have sleep. But this is often neglected. And we've talked about how important it is. It's important for your repair, for your immunity, for your emotional health, mental health, memory. So that's what sleep is all about.
That's correct. All right, ma'am. That was a very wonderful PPT. Actually, you covered a lot of aspects because I think everyone knows almost all these aspects, but it's just the time of, you know, they do not take out time to do the reality check that this is what wrong I'm doing with myself. You know, we keep watching the screens, we keep doing something, or we keep watching something or the other. And we do not try to, you know, switch off our brains and end up thinking like, I wish I had a button that I could just switch off my brain and just sleep.
Brain will shut off. Yeah.
It's just that it feels like that we do not want to work on it, but we just want God to come here and just switch the button off. And,
And also, I've seen that people are not having a good day, but they're not able to understand why is the day not good. So, you know, exactly. I just want that connection that, think about it, that when you've had a good night, how do you feel? And when you've had a bad night, how do you feel? So some thought has to come that, why am I not so good in the day?
Ma'am, actually, while talking to you, it just brings a question to me right now, like how I feel at times as well, like this. For example, what happens is you are very tired during the day. You know, you've been working out, or you know, you. So I did the fitness in the morning. I did working out, and I was at work during the day. And when I'm driving back home, so I'm falling asleep. But you know, I'm thinking that I just need to sleep right now. And as soon as I reach home, the sleep is gone.
Yeah.
You know, it's a how. Why does it happen?
So this is actually what we call as an association of the bed with sleep. So that has to be built up and it has to be stabilized. So two, three things are like this, that one, if you take a nap, even a very short nap at the end of the day, that will decrease your chances of having a good night's sleep.
Wow. Yes.
So it's called as something in our medical language, something called as a sleep drive. So imagine if you were to take small bits of food all through the day, and when comes the meal time, then you are say, I'm not very hungry.
Correct.
So if you have one little nap just when in the car, when people are driving back home, and then so that the drive has gone off. So by the time you reach home, you actually, so you feel wide awake and alert. So don't take a nap after a certain time. We actually advise after 3 p.m. type. So if somebody's very tired, want to put their head down, yes, a 10-15 minute, the concept of that power nap is a very good idea. But the timing of the nap, duration of the nap are very important. Yes, I have had a patient who was asleep coming home at 7:30 and said, I cannot keep my eyes open. So he sleeps. And then he's awake till 2 a.m. And then he can't get up for work the next day. So it's like it starts off a vicious cycle.
Right. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for that. And, you know, having known all the reasons you just mentioned, like what are the common reasons for not getting enough sleep? But when one should know that now is the time that I need to seek help. First of all, you know, that there's always, I just would like to tell people here that there is no harm in seeking help. But when is the right time to seek help?
Yeah, so I think by and large now people know what to do to get good sleep. But they are sometimes very simple things, but people are forgetting. So you'll be amazed that we kind of go over it with the individual again and again. So one simple analogy which I found was really good for everybody is that something called as a bedtime routine, and which is very good for children. So how do babies sleep? Has somebody seen a child sleep? You see how comfortably they sleep if they are put to bed rightly, and I'll tell you what happens with them. So they have a very good sleep. So they have what is called, and ideally should have, a routine that they play for during the day. They have a dinner, then they have a bathing, then they have some reading, and the mother puts them to sleep comfortably and they sleep through the night. Imagine if you were to do this, that you were giving the child the screen the whole day, the child will not eat well, is continuous crying. So you would not like the child to be in this state. So why would you do this to yourself? That you watch screens right till the end, you're eating right till the end, and then you think of going to bed, and that's what makes you very irritable, angry, stressed. So just remember that to get a good night, you have to have a good day routine and a bedtime routine. So which people are forgetting? They don't have a good routine and they don't have a good night routine. And they expect like a miracle, the sleep should be very good. There's a little hard work involved in this. So you focus on that. So keep a fixed time. Another thing people are doing is, people don't realize, is the weekdays and weekends. We have an internal body clock, which we set. So if you set your clock to 3 a.m., do not think that the next day you'll fall asleep at 12 midnight. It won't happen. So why and how, we'll talk later. So that's one thing. If use your bed only for sleep, make the bedroom very quiet and relaxing, comfortable temperature, light exposure, exercise regularly, and turn off all devices 30 minutes. So this is all something. What about caffeine? So what's happening is, when people are tired in the day, they drink a lot of caffeine during the day to stay awake and alert and productive. Caffeine can linger in your blood for almost 6 to 8 hours, and it will block the sleep producing hormones. So that's what it's doing to people. So they take coffee till about 5 p.m., 6 p.m., 7 p.m., and then they can't sleep. So please be careful. Take these very simple things. And I like this quote that, you know, let's make good sleep a culture. So each time I have a show, the people who are helping me organize it, the people who are viewing, I think each one should just take, like we have these pledges these days going around for Diwali, that each one is joining a pledge. I think each one should join and say, yet, yes, you know, I agree sleep is important and let's help each other. So like eat healthy, similarly sleep healthy. You wear a seatbelt, take care of yourself. You wear a mask. So we should just ensure, make your own recipe for good sleep. See, just because we are all unique individuals, maybe somebody does want to watch a show. So recently there was another nice article that we should not lay down too many rules and too many strict rules so people get more anxious. So if you want to watch a show, but you have a time to end the show. And make sure that your timing is all good and you have a good night. When to seek help? I guess it's clear from all this. Anything that you feel is going to interfere with your day. You get up feeling tired. The day is miserable. You cannot focus. You can't function at all. Second, if you get tempted or if somebody suggests that please take a sleeping pill. So we call them sleep aids. So somebody is trying alcohol to sleep. Somebody is actually trying substance to sleep. So I have had children telling each other that, you know, you try this, it's helped me, you'll also sleep. So with the result, it's actually harmed their thinking a lot more and created a lot of more anxiety and stuff like that. So if you think it's interfering with your the day, if you are getting emotional issues, memory, concentration, and do not get tempted to take a sleep aid without seeking help, because those then become really hard. People are taking sleeping pills, coming to us, and we're having a hard time trying to get them off. So we can measure sleep. I'm just showing you this picture that there are numerous techniques that one can do in this current scenario.
Totally. Thank you so much, ma'am. That was pretty insightful. But again, as you mentioned earlier, I think the timings you mentioned for, you know, that we have to time it, even if you want to watch the show, you should time yourself. But I think that's the problem of this generation. That we start watching something and like one more episode and yeah. we'll just end up finishing every season.
Yeah. So this is the availability, and another interesting discovery on this was that, so what is it that makes us watch this? What is it that creates this binge? So you'll be surprised to know, and the viewers should also know, is that when we think about anything that you do and you get a feeling of reward, you secrete a lot of nice, good chemicals. So it's like even if people who smoke or take alcohol, it produces the same feeling. So binge watching does that. So the body then craves it. So it is hard to make that. But when you know that, yes, it is hard, then you try all the more harder to, like you would try and do for any other addiction or substance or whatever. So then they have entered into that area of the brain. So they are producing a good feeling. So that good feeling to stop is a hard thing to do, but that's what we have to do.
That's true. And as we speak, I think we have a question from one of our viewers. And he says, during the lockdown, I was not working because the jobs and everything, it was all off. Of course, I was not working. Then I just got in a habit of not sleeping at all because I did not have anything productive to do the next day. So, and it has become my routine now. So what to do? Because now I have to go work, or even if I don't have to go to work.
These are the kind of people that I'm seeing now every day. Because that initial period, there was nothing. So they just pushed that cycle forward. And now they want to push it back. So it is possible. Firstly, it is all doable. There's nothing that we cannot achieve. But we have this new concept in medicine now, which I believe in a lot. It's called as participation. Meaning that we will give you some suggestions. You will follow them. We will work on it together and things will move. It's not the time and the day in our field that we give you a pill, you swallow it, and it's all done. And especially sleep medicine. So like I said, all those rules and regulations, we have a 4-week program or a 6-week program where we touch base once in a week. We give you some homework, you give us some information, we again approach it, and we help people move this cycle back and forth with some techniques and also maybe some medication which can just help move your cycle. But those medications will not work alone till we do not make an effort to move our cycle ourselves.
Great. Thank you so much, ma'am. I think in the last, I would like to ask you a very important question, I think, because everyone, we can all talk about the solutions. We can all talk about the problems. But the thing is that we can see that a lot of people are struggling with sleep right now because of a lot of probably it could be a pressure because of the time, because of this pandemic time. So can you suggest, and we all suggest all the viewers to do go, please go and see a sleep specialist to, you know, to correct your sleep pattern and everything. But ma'am, if you could suggest us, if you could probably tell us some exercises that could help us, you know, that could help the viewers in sleeping right away, or if there's anything, diet or any exercise routine which needs to be followed.
Yeah, so I kind of went over it a little fast, you know, that's make your own sleep recipe. That's what I think is going to work for you. So you, but there are those in that, there were just maybe 2 to 3 very important things. One is to keep a fixed bedtime and wake up time. Don't fluctuate that. 2 is get adequate light exposure during the day, because that in the daytime, it will shut off that sleep chemical. Otherwise, if it doesn't shut off, it'll just kind of linger and you will keep feeling dopey the whole day. Get some physical activity. So the body needs to be tired and mind needs to be relaxed. So day, and then, so this is what you do in the day. Then you have a section for the pre-bedtime. So whatever you need to do, you need a hot shower. Hot showers are good. Warm showers, they actually raise your body temperature, then they drop. So when the body temperature drops, sleep is much better. Make sure that your bedroom is conducive. If you do tend to worry and think a lot, we also tell people to do what is called as a journaling, or fix a worry time, fix a time that you write down everything and clear. So it's like very important to clear our head of all these thoughts. You know, the thoughts are actually have become a big problem for people. They're not able to shut off. Then when you lie in bed, you can do a simple breathing technique, which is that you just take a deep breath in, you can count 2, 2, 3 and release and exhale. So whole aim is that the brain has to start calming down. So you can do breathing. You can also do something called as visual imagery, which works that you think of some beautiful landscape, some memory, some picture in your mind, which you enjoyed in the pre-lockdown eras when you went for a nice vacation. And so there's a third technique, which is called as a muscle contraction relaxation. So something you need to do in that last 10 minutes or 8 minutes to break all the thoughts. Because if you switch off the gadgets and switch off the light and lie down, just remember the brain is going to be active. So if it's active, then you get out of bed, put the lights on or dim the lights and start the breathing. And if these don't work, then definitely you should seek help. But try all this. Caffeine should be stopped at a certain time. Late night gyms are a particular no, you know, because they are like stimulating. Anything which stimulates you and excites you will keep you awake. So start thinking about anything which can calm you down. So those will work.
That's a very good advice, ma'am. Thank you so much. And I think that's a very valuable, insightful thing to say, because a lot of people tend to overthink a lot. And they keep telling their friends and family that, you know, that I could not sleep because I just kept thinking about other stuff and about the future and probably the possible future, which might not even happen, that we're just trying to, you know, ruin our sleep. So that's a very good advice.
Yeah, just write everything down. So the brain will feel much lighter. You know, it's right. That's what we tell people.
Right, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you for this advice. I think viewers, I would like to request you just take up this advice and write about your day so that it takes out all the worries and all the overthinking which you're going to do, you know, on the instead of sleeping. So just it will be great if you can sleep instead. Thank you so much, ma'am. That was a very insightful session. Thank you so much. Thank you so much all for your time. And mainly, we really appreciate your time, Dr. Bhatia, because we know how valuable your time is. But before ending this, I request you to give a small message to our viewers.
So the message, like I'd said, that let's make good sleep a culture. Right. And let's all work together to just spread this message that good sleep is important. And let's not try and follow our peers or our mentors or leaders who say that they sleep 4 to 5 hours. Majority of us need a good 7 to 8 hours of sleep, which is important for our mental health, physical health, emotional health. So if we are doing, somebody said a very nice sentence that if we were to pay to get a pill like this, we would do anything. So this is free. So I think we should just make use of this, that what is internally within us, to put all our resources and get the good sleep and get the best pill possible.
That's a great message. Thank you so much, and that's a very great message. Thank you. So thank you so much all. And I hope that we've managed to answer all the queries and all, and the whole session could help you in any way. In the end, I would like to thank SpeakMed, a telemedicine platform, helping patients community through video consultations and connecting them with our award-winning doctors of national and international repute from all over the world. And we promise that we would keep coming again on a webinar with new and much needed topic to answer your queries by our senior experts. Thank you once again all, and please like, follow our SpeakMed page for healthier updates and download the app for a video consult with the doctors now. Ma'am, thank you so much. It was a pretty insightful session.
Thank you, Roger. And thank you, SpeakMed. And thank you, the viewers. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, ma'am.